Kelley, now that most of us have been in quarantine, we've had a lot of time to consider a lot of things, look at a lot of things. How have money habits changed now that we've been able to take a look at our money? Are we going to be looking at it differently now going forward?
I really think so, Larissa. And there's so much to unpack there because when we say money, is it spending? Is it investing? I'm talking to a lot of Canadians across the country that have had to stop RSP or TFSA contributions. Are they going to remember to reenact those, you know, get those good habits going again? So many people that really did not maybe quite understand the importance of an emergency account. I mean, so many people were sailing along doing just fine. No one could have predicted this. And then, of course, the uncertainty when it comes to your investments. I think it's been a wake-up call for a lot of people to maybe dig into their asset allocation. Maybe they didn't realize they were taking on as much risk that, you know, when they saw the volatility of their portfolio. Definitely something I've been hearing from a lot of Canadians as well. It was that, my goodness, are they going to be able to retire when they thought they were going to retire? So I don't think anyone, Larissa, is going to come out of COVID unscathed financially in some way, shape, or form.
I want to, you had just referenced these, I guess, an emergency fund, rather, is what I should be saying. And the Canadian government had obviously introduced an aid package for Canadians. You bring up this point that it really kind of underscores the fact that perhaps Canadians aren't prepared with an emergency fund. What is the barometer? What should that emergency fund look like?
And it's such a great point, Larissa. So going into the crisis, a lot of Canadians were in trouble already. The third quarter of 2019, we saw debt to income numbers at around 176%. So that meant for every dollar we brought in, we owed $1.76. Insolvencies on the rise. A number of surveys saying that nearly half of Canadians were $200 away or less from insolvency. So if you talk to someone like a certified financial planner, they're going to say that generally 3 to 6 months is what you want to either have liquid available to you. Now, that doesn't need to be in a savings account that you can go with your ATM or cash in the house, but that's not a bad idea to examine how much cash you should actually have on hand as well. Or that could be in the form of a line of credit. If you're a high income earner, 6 months' income could be a lot of money sitting doing nothing. So having that line of credit available to you when things are good, not when you've lost your job. And that I think is also a big wake-up call for a lot of people as well, that it is not the time to seek credit or you know, to be talking to your banker for new credit when you've already lost your job. You want to do your best to get on, you know, solid financial footing. So it's not a finger wagging by any means. Again, this took a lot of people by surprise, but I do think that a lot of people are going to be heeding that, you know, that important message, that fundamental tenet of financial planning, that you have that safety net there. It's interesting, Larissa, because the Canadian Payroll Association as well came out with a survey pre-COVID, just a couple of months pre-COVID, and it kind of contradicted some other numbers, some other surveys we've heard in the past, where happiness and well-being and a lack of stress when it comes to money increases as your income increases. But what their survey found was a sense of ease comes from having the cushion to withstand an emergency, and how interesting that was that they actually came up with that just a couple of months before COVID hit.
A lot of financial institutions, even insurance companies in this time, were offering deferred payments. You were now able to defer your mortgage, defer your auto insurance, your home insurance, etc. But in a few months from now, what happens? What does that picture look like, Kelly?
Yeah, and that's the thing. If people were already teetering on unsolid ground, it's going to underscore the importance, Larissa, of really sitting down with a professional. I don't know how you get out of this on your own. Sitting down with someone like a certified financial planner, a nonprofit credit counselor, if debt is screaming at you, and to really have a plan. You know, we'll have a plan when it comes to our health. We'll seek out a personal trainer, we'll count our calories, do things of that sort. Yet I can't tell you how many people reach out to me saying, you know, when they have a plan to pay off their debt, when they have a plan to retire. And it's like, why would you think that you need to navigate that all on your own? It's going to take some creativity, maybe some cutbacks, maybe some increased income. And we're not out of this yet. So will there be deferrals upon deferrals for some people? The banks are saying they're willing to work with people, and actually 90% of those that have reached out, the bank has approved those deferrals. But yes, it's going to be some catch up to really figure out how to get back on track.
With respect to something that you had just mentioned and not seeking out credit at this time, what about people, for example, tenants that didn't have a choice that tried to seek out these payday loans? I mean, they're high interest loans.
Yeah, there was a survey done by Acorn, and they really look at, you know, low to middle income Canadians. And this was at the beginning of actually the end of April, looking at, as you said, 15% of tenants not being able to make rent. So that wasn't really that far into COVID yet. So looking at payday loans and advances on your credit card, this is like an absolute last resort. The payday loans are very easy to get. You can hop online. They're really friendly. They take away that shame and embarrassment, and they promise to get money. And people have told me they've had money in their account within a couple of hours. Problem is, depending on the province that you're in, I mean, these are astronomical interest rates, like as high as 600% and even more. So it may solve that short-term problem, but what you're going to have to deal with in the future usually ends up being more payday loans, rolling into a really bad situation. Same with the cash advance from your credit card, not nearly as bad, but still 20 to 25% interest rate doing that. So it's really important that you look to every possible thing that you can do. Government benefits, as you said, deferring any type of bills that you can pay, and reaching out for help if you can't see any other way out.
Last resort, and I know that you had mentioned insolvency, and we know that we heard the stat in 2019 that 46% of Canadians were $200 away from insolvency. Is that the last resort?
I guess it depends if you talk to an insolvency trustee, if that would be the last resort. I mean, the courts are closed right now. Are we going to see, been talking to a lot of my friends in that industry saying that, you know, it's quiet right now because the creditors aren't coming right now. They're not calling. They're not, you know, you're still getting those deferrals. You're not having to pay them. Taxes, you can defer paying your taxes until the end of August. So as soon as September 1 rolls around and the taxes are due, a lot of these other creditors are starting to call. Will that be something people, you know, bankruptcy, is that an option for people? Certainly, I think that is a last resort, especially when you factor in there's a lot of jobs you can't take once you filed for bankruptcy. So that's really important as well, as to look at your overall, you know, picture, factoring in your career. But I mean, it certainly is something that a reality that some Canadians will unfortunately have to face.
What is the next step if you are facing debt?
So the most important thing if you're facing debt is to know your debt. Sounds really simple, but people feel shame and embarrassment, of course. It's not something that we feel good about as Canadians if you have debt. So many people are having to call up their bank that have never had to do that. They've always made their payments on time. They've never had to get a deferral. So that can be very, very difficult to do. So the most important thing is staying on top of it. Your creditor, who you owe money to, does not know your situation. They don't know if you need help. They don't know if you can't make this month's payment, you can do it next month, or then you can't the month after. So knowing your debt, talking to your creditors, if you can't, reaching out to that professional, if it's a nonprofit credit counselor or an insolvency trustee, all of them will give you a free call. And then really, Larysa, keeping track of when your payments are due, how much they are, when those deferrals are done. Maybe you got 6 months on the mortgage, but you only got a 3-month deferral on your credit card. Put those details into your digital calendar and then set a little reminder to remind you 2 weeks out to make sure you're making that payment again, because of course, a lot of people have kids and spouses at home and a lot of distractions. And also to remind you that if you still need a deferral, to get on with your bank earlier than later, and don't go too close to your due date, because it usually takes about 5 business days for that deferral to kick in. So don't start calling your bank or your credit card company just a couple of days before saying, look, you need more time. Get on that early.